I'm Vishnu Vardhini from Verizon India. So today I'm going to talk about GitLab CI/CD. So how many of you are using GitLab as a source code management tool? So I think you're aware of the features provided by GitLab. So before that, I just want to give you an overhead about CI/CD in general. So as you guys know, every organization is moving towards CI/CD and optimizing the tools, and as well as driving CI/CD with various DevOps tools. So every day a new tool gets into picture and we try venturing out. And all this and all this chaos is to achieve one common goal, which is to how fast a team can deliver the results. So that is the one common goal. So in general, I'd like to talk about the CI/CD workflow. So consider I have a team and we have a locally implemented feature. So when I locally committed to my source code management tool, say any kind of a Git or a Stash or a Bitbucket, any kind of Atlassian tool, so it must automatically trigger a CI/CD pipeline. And that should be triggered based upon various rules. Say if there is a merge request and then there is a commit or any kind of trigger, that trigger should actually trigger a pipeline. And the pipeline is in generally going to have a set of automated rules like build, scan, test, and so on. So once the feature is okay and the review is completed, it is moved to the higher environments like prod. And if something goes wrong in the worst case scenario, it should be rolled back to the previous working state. So all these things should be happening in an automated fashion. So in order to do this, we generally pick up tools from the market or our favorite tools like GitHub or Jenkins CI, Travis CI, or for artifactory management, we pick up Nexus or JFrog, and for Jira as a issue tracking. So the sky is the limit. We have so many tools in market. And as well as for deployment, we do the AWS deploy or any kind of deployment tool which is favorable for the application, right? So in order to avoid all this, GitLab came up with an application lifecycle management. So in GitLab, it is a powerful tool built to perform the entire CI/CD in single place without much of a third-party intervention. So the goal is to do the entire CI/CD pipeline in a single place. GitLab is also called as a single suit for the DevOps pipeline or the life cycle. So what are the features provided by GitLab? So GitLab provides, as you all know, it's a distributed system, and we use it as a source code management tool. The other features is GitLab CI/CD. And the other features of GitLabs are GitLab Wiki, GitLab Issues, which is for issue tracking like Jira. And GitLab Wiki is very much similar to the Confluence pages. And it also provides registry management, which is a replacement for like artifactory management. So all these are provided by GitLab. And the most favorite and the current buzzword is the GitLab CI/CD. Since it is much better than actually maintaining a lot of tools in the market, right? So we do not need the licenses of many tools, or we do not need people to maintain various tools. Say for DevOps, DevOps person would only do the CI using the Jenkins, and we need the infra team to maintain the infra or the deployment activity. And we need the dev team in order to create a merge request or review the merge request. So all these teams despite their own activities, they need to concentrate on these as well. So GitLab CI/CD resolves this. So it's a kind of replacement for many kind of a CI servers like Jenkins. GitLab also, GitLab does CI using the GitLab runners. So runners are very much similar to the Jenkins build nodes or the build slave. So these are the this runner can be created using a shell or as well as a Kubernetes or a Docker executor. Another important feature of GitLab CI/CD is it's in Jenkins we need to maintain all the plugins and we need to concentrate on the updates of the plugins. But whereas in GitLab CI/CD that is not required, since it has another feature called the auto DevOps. So in auto DevOps, you need not maintain a list of tools like for doing the quality gateway using Sonar, or say if you need to communicate with if there is any vulnerability, you need to create an issue using say Jira, we need not go to the external tools. Inside GitLab itself, we are having a tab called the GitLab issues, and we'll be able to create it. Let's consider a scenario. So I am from a dev, say I am from a dev team, and when I create a merge request, the merge request is created in GitLab, right? So the person who's created it has a committer name. So once the a snippet or a code is committed, if that particular code is having a, say, a vulnerability, that has to be notified to the dev team, and a correspondent person should be assigned to it. So this is completely achievable in GitLab. You not go about creating a external hook to Jenkins, or you need not need a plugin to create a ticket in Jira. So what you can do is you can just create a CI/CD pipeline file. So it's an YAML file which is going to have the steps to execute or instructions which you need to perform. It's very much similar to the pipeline as a code, but it is written in YAML. So how it can be done is, so when I create a merge request, the GitLab is going to trigger the pipeline, right? So inside the pipeline file, I'm going to say that, see, if this particular snippet is having a vulnerability, create a issue in GitLab issues and assign the committer name to it. So this creates accountability within the dev team, and we need not go about looking for random people and asking them to fix for the current, if there's a release, we need not ask for people to fix that. So this is one of the benefit of having a source code management and the CI together. So in Verizon, we actually concentrate on the security a lot, and we do not promote or release the code to the release environments or higher environments if it doesn't pass the security rules. So this particular use case was hugely used in our organization. And another thing about GitLab is that it is natively supporting Docker. You need not go about looking for plugins, or you need not go about looking for any kind of external documentations to achieve that. So if you guys have your own Docker images, say, if in your organization, you're going to do a Sonar quality gateway, you need not go about looking for plugins. So if you have a Docker image in place, and that can be automatically plugged in or called in your CI file, and you can readily use it. So while using this, so this was a very interesting story happened for us. So when let me give an example with Jenkins itself, since it's a very much familiar tool. So consider you're running Jenkins as a container, and on top of that you're having a build node or a build slave, which is also which is also running as a container. On top of it, for say XYZ application, you need to do a CI/CD pipeline. So for consider it has a Maven build, which is also running as a, you have a Maven image, and it is also running as a Maven container. So as you see, there are three level of containers in your this scenario. So when you have three containers, obviously you're going to have three daemons, and communicating between them is going to be a little a lower or higher level performance issue, or there's a high chance that your host daemon might be crashed, or you're going to lose all the three images. Say if you're an organization, you're going to practice reusability, and you guys have a Docker images which is in a reusable fashion. So in that case, if you crash the Docker images, that's going to be an overhead for you in creating it again. So to resolve that, we actually found out that Docker is providing a service called the DIND. So DIND is nothing but Docker inside Docker. So the advantage of this is that you can have multiple containers pinned up on top of that using DIN. So how it is happening is that you're going to, at the end of the day, you're going to have a host machine with daemon. But the container which is pinned on top of it would not be having its own daemon, but it would be communicating with the host daemon. So in this scenario, what would happen is you would get an encapsulated environment. So this means that there will be no performance leak or any kind of a image crash, because your host images or Docker images are not getting tampered. So we believe in reusability, and we have a set of reusable images, and we do not want to lose them. So while we tried out this the example quoted in Jenkins, please try to replicate that in GitLab. So GitLab is actually is running as a container. So it supports native containers because GitLab runs on top of a container. So you have a GitLab runner, which is also a container. And on top of that, if you guys have a container-based application deployment, it is going to be useful by using the DIN as a service. So this was a success story for us. Hope you guys use GitLab and figure out whether it's useful for you guys as well. Thank you.